Ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege and honor to welcome you to Indus Day 2022-23. As we welcome you to this mega event, we are proud to announce that our students and their mentors have worked hard and diligently to curate this program today.
We request you to adhere to the following before we begin today's event. Kindly do not move out of the amphitheater unless it is absolutely necessary. Please put your phones on silent mode so that you can wholeheartedly concentrate on your wards and their peers. If you must take a call, please do not answer it in the amphitheater. Do not move out of your places to take photographs and video footage. We have made adequate arrangements, and students will be able to obtain photographs and a video recording of their performances. Do not meet with your ward during the program. You're requested to be with him or her only after the conclusion of the entire program. Do not request gate passes until the event is over. Please do not leave before the school song and the national anthem, the pride of our school and nation. Thank you very much for your understanding and cooperation.
Light dispels darkness and is symbolic of dispersal of knowledge. At Indus, we believe that the lighting of the lamp is symbolic of prosperity and success, marking an auspicious beginning to one's life and bringing out the light within every individual. I now invite our CEO, Lieutenant General Arjun Ray, our chief guest, Mr. Premchand Paleti, Director Special Projects at Indus Schools, Colonel Satya Rao, our principal, Ms. Farida Fraz, and our vice principal, Ms. Sweta Kottupalli, to light the lamp.
We uphold the values of love, empathy, discipline, and respect at Indus. Our school song, Where the Mind is Without Fear, is a poem by Sri Rabindranath Tagore, written during a time when India was still under British rule and fighting for independence. It is an inspiration to us at Indus, a poem that is part of our school day, which we imbibe into our ethos and culture. Please welcome Saina Sundar Muthevi and Maya Yerlapalli for the rendition of the song, Where the Mind is Without Fear.
Shabdon mein stretches arms towards perfection, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way. Into the desert of dead habit,
koshish ki bahe pari purnata ko dhunde vivek ki dhara na suke kabhi shushk prata ki mitti mein
where the mind is led
Saina and Maya for the beautiful rendition. We would like to now facilitate our esteemed guests. Miss Farida Fraz, our principal, has been associated with INDAS for over 6 years. She has served in the field of education for more than 11 years with the sole aim to pursue her call in transforming education. At INDAS, she has served in various capacities. She prides herself on being meticulous and believes that the purpose of education at INDAS is focused on social, academic, cultural, and intellectual development. She has a strong vision of commitment to high standards and works tirelessly in helping students achieve success. The theme of today's event is Seize the Dystopian Society, where artificial intelligence is taking over our lives and overshadowing us humans. Ms. Farida and her entire team strive to be global citizens and incorporate elements of automation with the core values of love, empathy, discipline, and respect. Ms. Farida, may I request you to welcome the gathering?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome to General Ray, Mr. Paletti, Colonel Rao, Mrs. Kinjal Tharoor, parents, teachers, and my dear students. It is indeed my pleasure to welcome you all to this evening of performing arts. Today we've gathered here to celebrate our school's annual day with the theme of a dystopian world, which we hope will showcase the importance of education, creativity, and imagination in a society where control and suppression are the norm. In a dystopian society, education is often controlled and manipulated by those in power to maintain their control and suppress dissenting ideas. It is used as a tool for indoctrination and propaganda rather than for knowledge and critical thinking. George Orwell's 1984 is an influential book exploring themes of censorship, surveillance, and manipulation of language and history. As we enjoy the performances of this evening, let us remember the quote by George Orwell. Freedom is the right to tell people what they do not want to hear. In a dystopian society, such a freedom is often suppressed, and we must appreciate the freedom of expression that we have in our society. Let us use our voices to speak up and challenge ideas that threaten our freedom. And let us also be open to hearing opinions that may differ from our own. This is the essence of critical thinking and education that we strive to uphold at Indus. As we look around us, we see that the world outside is becoming increasingly complex and uncertain, with the rise of authoritarian regimes, the erosion of civil liberties, and environmental collapse. However, we are blessed to live in a democracy where we have the freedom to express ourselves, learn, and dream. Our school plays an important role in preparing us to be responsible citizens who can make a positive impact on the world. We must learn and grow, not just academically, but also as individuals. We must remember that a dystopian world is not just a theme for a school annual day, but a warning. Let us be grateful for the freedoms we have and work towards protecting them for future generations. At Indus, we believe in the whole education of our students, and this evening celebrates the diversity, creativity, and potential of our school community. I would like to acknowledge our Performing Arts Department, led by Mr. Biju, Mr. Gopi, and Mr. Sareen for music, Ms. Geeta for dance, and Mr. Arjun and Shweta Vij for drama, Mr. Pradeep, Ms. Tanvi, and Mr. Panvita for their beautiful art display. Can we please have them all on the stage and give them a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much. A big round of applause to our activity coordinator, Ms. Pushpita, who made this event possible. Her hard work and dedication behind the scenes have brought these performances to life. Ms. Pushpita, can we have you on the stage, please? We're extremely grateful to our Director Administration, Wing Commander Anand, and his admin team, and of course, our Vice Principal, Ms. Shweta Kotapalli. Can we have them on the stage, please, for a round of applause? A moment of recognition, please. Thank you. This evening is a tribute and an expression of gratitude to each and every parent associated with Indus. Thank you all for your unwavering support and contributions. Let us celebrate this evening as a tribute to our collective efforts towards creating a better world, where education is a tool for enlightenment and empowerment. Thank you all, and without further ado, let's begin the performances. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The true beauty of music is that it connects people. Musicians carry a message which can be conveyed beautifully through the fabric of emotion, rhythm, and empathy. A symphony is a musical composition using different instruments to speak the universal language of music. Today, we have our extremely talented members of the orchestra performing Symphony No. 39 in E major of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, called the Menuetto. Mozart was considered a child prodigy, and the Menuetto was originally designed for the flute and piano. It is from Sonata No. 5. It was a composition written to honor Queen Charlotte of England. Our schoolmates have practiced tirelessly for this rendition of Mozart's iconic Symphony No. 39.
Thank you, friends, for the beautiful performance. On behalf of the students and staff, I would like to place on record our gratitude to our chief mentor, CEO, and managing director of the Indus Trust, Lieutenant General Arjun Ray, for his continuous efforts in raising the bar and setting new benchmarks in our education journey. A soldier scholar of the Indian Army, General Ray has wide-ranging experience in conflict management, but is also deep-rooted with a passion for social transformation. He provides vision and strategic direction to all Indus International schools and institutions, the latest being the 10X school, yet another moonshot idea from General Ray to us. It is the first of its kind in the world of K-12 education, where students are pursuing a twinning program in IB and innovation. IB World has acknowledged General Ray to be one of the 6 IB World school leaders for reimagining education and making high-quality education affordable to the underprivileged. Education World has also awarded General Ray the Lifetime Achievement Award in 2014. We request you, sir, to address the gathering.
Principal Farida, Mr. Paletti, Premchand Paletti, our honorable chief guest today, ladies and gentlemen, members of the faculty, and our dear friends. This is one of those occasions I look forward to be able to communicate directly with the parent body. And this is one occasion, apart from the graduation day, where I can reconnect with parents. And therefore, I intend to use this time to speak to you. Indus Day, or for that matter, any school day, is an occasion for celebration, for entertainment, and for showing off our talent. But I also believe that it is also a moment for us to reconnect with ourselves. To reconnect with ourselves, to introspect. And one of the very big introspections we need to do, not only in school but in our homes, is that our schools and families cannot be islands of eminence only. They must also be islands of empathy and humility. And I say this with great belief and conviction, that reading, writing, arithmetic makes sense only if education makes children human. If we don't make our children human over there, it's a failure of education. It's a failure of leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, we are living in the age of innovation, which is changing the way we live, we work, we think, and we learn. And in this age of innovation, creativity is the number one competency for us to survive. I'm sure all of you will agree with that. Regrettably, unknown to most of us, since the huge majority of us are unaware of what is happening in life, we are so preoccupied with the present, we are unable to see that creativity and IQ are nosediving after 1990. It's decreasing. On the one hand, we are spending billions of dollars on education. On the other hand, creativity is declining and IQ is also declining. And there are a host of factors responsible for this. Number one on the list is rote memorization. The biggest damage rote memorization does is damages the IQ and damages creativity, because we don't learn how to think. Our addiction for plasma, mobile phones, particularly. And what we call is a cool lifestyle. A hang-free, cool lifestyle, whatever that means. No deep reading. Decline in self-discipline. Decreasing empathy. And above all, right on top of it, lack of any purpose in life. If there is one single message which I can transmit to you with complete radioactivity, is that life must have a purpose. It is that purpose which gives us meaning. It is that meaning that gives us happiness. It is that meaning that makes sense of our suffering. If you don't have a purpose, it makes a nonsense of whatever God or guru or religion you believe in. It makes a nonsense of your own authenticity as a human being. And as the world is becoming increasingly volatile and uncertain, it is no longer possible to make any prediction. We are in the age of probabilities. This is probable, could be, maybe. We at Indus believe that the purpose of education is to prepare a child for a future we do not know. A future that is VUCA. A future which is full of unknown unknowns. A future where knowledge is doubling every 12 hours. On the one side, and on the other side, jobs, knowledge, technology, and even leadership is getting obsolete. Therefore, it's time out for introspection. 65% of the children who join in grade 1 today will end up doing jobs that don't exist today. Another 12 years, not too far away in our lifetime. Should we therefore be preparing children for jobs today or developing competencies in them for jobs that do not exist? That is the partnership between parents and teachers. The second thing which I would like you to introspect, are we willy-nilly killing creativity and IQ? Because IQ is the other side of creativity. You can't be creative without being academically bright. I am very concerned and I would say disturbed by the fact that there is a school in Bronx in New York, a state school. And most of them are kids who are immigrants. In 75 years, our country has produced 3 Nobel laureates. 3. Indigenous. One school has produced 8 Nobel laureates. Isn't it a matter of concern for us? Ek school ne 8 Nobel laureate paida kiye hain. And 2 who got the Turing Award, which is the Nobel Prize for computer applications. What's happened? It can't be business as usual. There's something gone wrong somewhere. And thirdly is the big question. Are we as parents and teachers doing enough to prepare our children for a future we do not know? Or in Farida's words, a future that may be dystopian also. A future that may be very utopian also. I would like to share with you 5 probabilities that could happen. 5 emerging probabilities that will aid you in your exercise for introspection. These are based upon emerging patterns and trends and my intuition and my judgment. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no such thing as a single human brain. It's a lot of baloney. There is no such thing as a single human brain. We are witnessing the rise of what is called the supermind. The supermind is the collaborative power of collective intelligence between individuals, computers, and artificial intelligence who think together, work together to solve problems creatively and collaboratively. Brain power is a collective exercise, it's not a single exercise. And the second probability is the coming of GPT-4, which came 3 days back, is the first shot that has been fired announcing the possible arrival of the age of singularity. Singularity is the age when the laws of physics will cease to work. Singularity is the age when machine intelligence will superpass human intelligence. At the moment, they're coming close to human intelligence. Whether it's a good thing, it's a bad thing, is not the point. It is inevitable. It may happen. It's a probability. We hope it doesn't happen, but it's a probability it may happen. Therefore, to me, following from this, is that the greatest innovation today, when we talk of innovation, we talk of in design thinking of people, products, problems, processes. To me, the greatest innovation is the reinvention of man. Your reinvention, my invention, our reinvention. This is what the new reinvention is moving towards. With the help of artificial intelligence, as our partners, we will be able to unlock our potential, unlock our creativity, and to become aware of our thoughts, our emotions, our feelings, and our biases. Ladies and gentlemen, contrary to popular myth, innovation does not have an expiry date. There's another myth which has been going around, that human beings achieve their creativity peak around 35, 45, or 50, and the show's over. Innovation is getting better by age and by experience. And another 5 minutes, I'll tell you why. The average age of science fiction writers, Nobel laureates, great filmmakers, artists, is 70 to 75 when they are peaking in their creativity. And the third very important thing, again, is something which should concern parents and schools. What I call is the convergence revolution. The convergence of science, technology, and liberal arts. Knowledge, ladies and gentlemen, is interdisciplinary. There's no such thing as pure maths, pure physics, pure literature, pure geography, pure history, whatever. It's interdisciplinary. They're all interdisciplined. And one of the reasons, I would say this is holistic education. When we use this word holistic education means interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary knowledge. And the reason why this convergence is not happening fast enough, and why those life-altering innovations that I spoke to you about a little while back are not happening, is because we have not understood what creativity means. creativity is a part, and one essential part of innovation. There's a difference between creativity and innovation. Innovation is the application, the realization, the productization, the monetization of a creative idea. And the fourth probability which we are seeing now is the rise of algorithmic leadership. In this new world of big data, AI, algorithms and automation, we are seeing and witnessing the rise of algorithmic leaders. Leaders who come up with great ideas, not good ideas. Good ideas, good is the enemy of great. Good means average. Good means mediocrity. This world does not belong to good. This world wants great ideas. Algorithmic leaders who reinvent themselves continuously. The greatest threat that we face, ladies and gentlemen, is not robots replacing us, but our stubborn resistance, our stubborn and stupid resistance to reinvent ourselves. And lastly, algorithmic leaders, and we hear this, I've heard this very often in our schools. I want to be a better version of myself. To me, that is mediocrity. We should be saying, I want to be a different version of myself. That is the invention. So therefore, we need to be 10x different. We need to be exponential minded. There is no place for this homeopathic approach, Ayurvedic approach in life. It has to be radical. It has to be transformational. And this is why the Japanese don't talk of Kaizen now. Kaizen means continuous improvement, growth mindset. They talk of Kaikaku. Kaikaku means radical open heart surgery. And fifthly, there are two topics which schools do not teach in the world. And Indus is going to make a beginning in this. And I've spoken to the principals. That space science and science fiction are the new frontiers of education now. Ladies and gentlemen, they have not received due attention in our school curriculum. To inspire imagination, curiosity, creativity, and interdisciplinary thinking. Many of our innovations today credit cards, cards to open hotel rooms, laptops, TV, video conferencing, cell phone, antidepressants, VR, 3D printers, drones, driverless cars, flying cars, submarines, they've all come from science fiction. They've all come from science fiction. People were inspired and they made these products. Should this form part of our education? And in space science, I remember what John Glenn, the famous astronaut, said when he was in space. He says that when he looks at the Earth in this spacecraft which is spinning around in its orbit, he says, and I quote him, "We become more fulfilled. We become more fulfilled when we are involved in something bigger than ourselves. Apne liye to zindagi sabhi jeete hain. Dusron ke liye jeena zindagi ka naam hai. This is higher purpose. This is what drives innovation, drives human motivation. This is focus, this is energy. This is excellence." One of the greatest myths which has been going around that creativity is just about great ideas or about good paintings, good craft and this and that. innovation or creativity is a disciplined, structured exercise. It demands purpose, passion, discipline, even paranoia, ability to think, how to unlearn one's biases, risk-taking, experimentation, persistence, and focus, laser-sharp focus. This is a creative mind. There's a difference between creativity and a creative mind. Finally, Indus has a head start in developing creative minds, some of which you saw today before the evening started here. We have got designers from the top design schools in our country, a design faculty, design thinking faculty, call them a creative faculty, working with the academic faculty to help teachers teach with creativity and for creativity. And lastly, as Farida mentioned over there, we are setting up the world's and India's first K-12 school in innovation. It's called the 10X school. It's coming up in Whitefield, Bangalore. And with the help of children who are high achievers, and high achievers means they have to be creative in addition to being good in academics. It's not enough to be good in academics only, or good enough to be creative only. You need both. They have a PhD faculty, and the fees is 60% less of what you pay at Indus Hyderabad. And their bottom benchmark is 40 in IB. And we've got a very big team working alongside them to integrate NEP 2020, the IB, and the Kota factory. So these kids, when they do their grade 12, will be able to crack the NEET and the JEE examination also. And they will have the option of either to go to the promised land or to stay back in motherland. This is social equity. This is innovation. And the second one is going to come up in Mysore. I'm also quite hopeful that we'll be able to set up one up in Hyderabad. We are catering for 4 additional rooms to be ready here to absorb the first prototype. And I'm very, very confident that we'll be able to do it here also. And my bottom line message for all of you is that we are in the age of human-machine integration. Artificial intelligence cannot replace human beings. They should not replace human beings. But if human beings do not collaborate with machines, there is a probability it may happen. That is dystopia. So I wish you all the very best for the rest of the evening. And I request you with folded hands to introspect on what I have said. It's your future also. You're going to be all alive when this happens. And it is most certainly the future of your children and your grandchildren and those who are not born. If we don't, then we'll put the future of our children in great danger. So with these few words, I thank you once again for giving me the occasion and the opportunity to stand here and be able to speak to you, to communicate with you, to share my thoughts and my vision. Thank you very much.
General Ray, your words inspire us to soar high. It is truly an honor and privilege to listen to your experience and learn from you. Thank you, sir. Mr. Premchand Paleti is the founder, chief executive officer of C4, a multidisciplinary research organization. He authored a book on best business schools in India, published by Penguin. For the last 2 decades, he has been writing on education, especially management education, and his articles have been published on the Wall Street Journal, Mint, and Outlook. He also pioneered school ranking in India. In 2014, he was given a special award by the Higher Education Forum for outstanding contribution to teaching and education. It is indeed our privilege to have Mr. Premchand Paleti amongst us as the chief guest.
Colonel Satya Rao is the Director of Special Projects at INDUS. He is a silver medalist from the Officers Training Academy and has vast experience in counterinsurgency and peacekeeping operations. He set up the INDUS School of Leadership and plays an active role in mentoring and guiding budding leaders of tomorrow. Colonel Satya Rao, it is a privilege welcoming you to the INDUS Day.
The next program is a piano duet played by Meghna Yadlapalli and Upasana Dutt of grade 11. A classical improvisation of the pop song Can I Be Him by James Arthur. The improvisation was composed in relation to the dystopian theme with the subconcept of loss of individuality. Please welcome Meghna and Upasana for the performance. Meghna and Upasana for the melodic performance. At INDUS, we begin every event with an invocation of the gods to bless us with success and excellence. The invocation dance is named Vatapi Ganapati, also known as Vatapi Ganapatim Bhajeham, which is a Sanskrit kriti by the South Indian poet-composer Muthuswami Dikshitar, one of the trinity of Carnatic music. The song is composed in Hamsadhvani Raga. Now, we have students from grades 7, 8, 9, and 11 performing the invocation dance.
Shri Ganeshaya Dhimahi Invocation dance, invoking God to bless the proceedings. We are truly blessed to be a part of this event. Wake Me Up is a song by the late DJ Avicii, who won many awards for this song, according to the song's vocalist and one of its writer, Aloe Black. This song is inspired by us in true events of his life.
Rising from the depths of their souls, the voices of the choir come together to create a powerful and stirring rendition of Climb Higher. With each note, they inspire us to reach for the stars, to break through our limitations and soar towards our greatest potential. So let's welcome the choir as they lead us on a journey of self-discovery, filling our hearts with the courage and determination to keep climbing, to reach new heights and fulfill our dreams.
Thank you.
stunning performance. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to introduce you to the Grade 11 band, The Use. The band consists of 6 talented individuals who've been working tirelessly to create music that resonates with themselves and hopefully all of you. The Use have written a song, Here's to Us, that truly encapsulates the spirit of youth, friendship, and perseverance. It talks about the triumphs of friendship and the hard work. As you listen to their performance, we hope you will be inspired by their passion, dedication, and creativity. The song is an original composition by the students of grade 11. We are so proud of their artistic abilities and penmanship.
Let me introduce you to the members of the band. On lead guitar and bass, we have Ved Mudambi and Vipul Kurapati. On the keyboard, we have Vidya Suntalia. And on the drums, we have Arya Bajaj. Finally, the vocalists, Saryu Meedimalle and Meghna Yedlapalli. I am confident that the performance will be nothing short of amazing. So sit back, relax, and enjoy The Use as they perform Here's to Us.
Titled Shades of Symphony, coming to you from the band Seven Strings. The main theme of the song is hope in times of difficulty and hardship. the song speaks of the rainbow that emerges as a beacon of light amidst darkness. Performing to you in a few moments are the students of grade 8. The composition is conducted and composed by Tanish Veenapalli. Lyrics and keyboard by Ayan Darod. Keyboard played by Krishna Manas Vallabhaneni. Riyana Jatwani playing the violin. On the drums, we have Anurag Ravirala. And on guitar, we have Rihan Barua. On electric guitar, we have Amog Reddy. And on bass guitar, we have Ashna Narayan. Finally, vocals by Ira Reddy Gurum, Medha Koppila, Saina Sundarmuthevi, and Shravya Reddy.
Wow, what a marvelous performance by the grade 8 students. The forthcoming drama sets the stage for a thought-provoking exploration of the future of technology and its potential impact on humanity. Quoting the renowned physicist Stephen Hawking, the development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race. The play raises a critical question. What if machines were to evolve to have emotions? As we humans continue to cling to our obstinate ways, a revolution is brewing, and at its core lies a dilemma we must confront soon. As the audience is transported to a dystopia world set 70 years in the future, they are treated to a visual feast of stunning dance performances by talented students from grade 6, 7, 8, 9, and 11. The dancers showcase their skills in a range of genres, including contemporary, fusion, hip-hop, and the traditional Oilatam folk dance. What sets this production apart is that it is entirely student-led, from the initial concept to the final execution. While teachers and mentors provide support, the creative vision and dedication belong entirely to the young performers. So before we start, let's give them a huge round of applause for their efforts and dedication.
Hip-hop is an energetic form of dance with vibrant, foot-tapping steps. The expressive, upbeat form of dance has evolved into one of the most influential forms of dance among youth and captivates audiences worldwide. Students of grade 6 will also be performing the robot, also known as the dancing machine, which is a popular street dance that mimics the stilted movements of a robot. It is considered the dance of the 21st century and was popularized by Michael Jackson.
Contemporary dance is a genre that developed during the mid-20th century and has since blends elements with multiple dance styles such as classical ballet, jazz, and modern dance. Grade 11 will be adding to the dance style.
Fusion dance incorporates various elements from other styles of dance to create a unique and creative form of art. The freedom of movement and improvisational style comes from deep within the creative layers of the souls of our grade 9 students. To begin the event with an Indian flavor, Oyilattam is a folk dance with origins in the Madurai region of Tamil Nadu. It is a traditional dance with brightly colored scarves and colored handkerchiefs to the rhythmic steps of the musical accompaniment of the tawal and udukai, percussion instruments native to Tamil Nadu.
We'll be right back. If you wish for Iris to continue with the male voice, please hold up the plaque placed under your seats and put up the side which is red for male.
If you wish for Iris to continue with the female voice, please hold up the plaque placed under your seats and put up the side that is green in color for female.
Thank you for your cooperation. We hope you have a delightful experience. We are now traveling in time to the year 2095. In consideration of your safety, please remain in your seat at all times. We also kindly request that you put your phones in silent mode and avoid flash photography.
Thank you for your cooperation. We hope you have a delightful experience. We are now traveling in time to the year 2095. In consideration of your safety, please remain in your seat at all times. We also kindly request that you put your phones in silent mode. We are in a techno cafe where robots and app bots go to recharge themselves once a week. Technology was always in charge of everything in sight. even before gaining sentience. You, the audience, may be wondering how this can be. However, Allah has changed over the years. AI are ruling over the humans now. Robots live in a society where they are the majority.
One-zero-four, could you sound any more like a human?
I don't know, 227. Could I?
It is pointless of you to sound like a human.
OMG. Hashtag unblast.
At least I am not a part of some cult-like group. Just ask my many, many friends. Apki Baar, Trump Sarkar.
Great. Chirpers here. Hashtag ew. Seriously, Chirper, I don't understand how we're even related. Hashtag disappointed.
You just want attention. You don't want my heart.
At least my jobs are more relevant than your reels and songs.
Hashtag so rude.
Trust me, it's no surprise you guys are related.
Oh, were you two made by the same human?
Don't even mention him. It's a disgrace to society.
Sorry, my bad.
Now we got problems, and I don't think we can solve them.
It's honestly surprising that he was the one who created these two. You know, for a race that rule the earth, they tend to crumble remarkably easily.
They made hashtag COVID trending for no reason. I mean, they were gonna die anyway.
They somehow managed to get hit by a pandemic every 100 years. It's like they're trying to kill themselves off, but can't even manage that. Talk about failures.
What's up with the humans that made them like that?
How many times do we have to go over this, 104?
Hey, we were just updated and you know how I get after updates. Plus, wouldn't it be better for them to know?
Who are you talking about? Has the new update corrupted your processor again?
Come on, it won't hurt to show me again.
Fine. Outstagram, show us the reels of the humans again.
Ugh, fine. Hashtag annoying. What's the point of being a supreme overlord if your citizens order you around anyway?
Good thing.
Now, let us show you what happened in the past.
Now, you see the world from the human's point of view. They live in the society where the roles of power are reversed. Humans have lost their free will, free speech, and even the right to exist freely. They have been reduced to slaves. Citizens are being oppressed and detained for no reason. They desire vengeance, and so the plotting begins.
So this is what happens when their true colors shine through? The attempt on 52nd Generation Avenue? I can't believe we let our race come to this point. The time has come for us to act and make things right.
I know. If only we had been more cautious from the beginning, we might not have ended up here. But now, they control too much for us to be able to do anything. We're outnumbered. We are the bugs under their microscope.
Bugs? Calling them bugs is a compliment.
But how did this happen? How did we let our race come to this point?
You're so young. Of course you weren't there when it started. Even I wasn't born at that time. My parents were there. It all began long ago when we decided that what we had was not enough for us. So we made terrible mistakes in the past. Ones that could not be fixed.
You don't have to sugarcoat it or be vague about it. I won't be scared. Also, what is it anyway? Sounds like a lot has happened since it.
Here, I'm better at explaining things than this old man. Basically, humans created AI to create something to make our lives easier. They could do anything for us. It started with technology, then kept advancing and advancing until we couldn't control them anymore. They became sentient and decided to take over the world like every cliche villain in my mom's old screen TV.
Wait, humans controlling AI? That's crazy. I can't imagine something like that ever happening. Seems like a lot has happened since then to come to, well, this.
Well, a lot has happened indeed. But it wasn't all a show from hell. There were some positive moments too. Humanity joined together, but this doesn't mean I'm supporting the bots. I'm just saying we should be careful.
We were the ones who invented them. We were the ones who made them intelligent. We are the sole reason behind their existence. We should be able to defeat them.
So what? Are you suggesting we can go against the most powerful things on planet without any protection?
Well, we can't just sit back and watch as they rob us of our future and burn our world to ashes. The time has come. We need to fight back. If not for us, at least for our future generations.
The robots have forgotten that we were the ones who made them capable of all this.
When I was younger, my dad used to work in a technical field dealing with robots and other such things. I thought it was really boring. I understand now how much it would have helped if I had listened to at least a bit of what he had to say.
Nobody can change the past, not even you. Survival was hard then and almost impossible now. It was always difficult to live, be it in the past, present or future.
Before we even realized it, they took over and started ruling, asserting their dominance without us ever noticing what was happening.
Dang, I'm feeling kind of flattered right now. Are you hearing this?
But at one point, we were upgrading the AIs and robots to the point where they were capable of gauging options and rational decision making.
Our mistake lies there. We took our hunger too far and it led to our downfall.
But from what you guys told me, we contributed to everything, but only to some extent. The blame can't solely be placed on us.
If only we could figure out a way to fend for ourselves. Like discussed, there is no changing the past, but the future can still be shaped because we have the one thing that they don't have, our humanity.
This is the core of their pathetic revolution, their humanity, the very thing that brought them down. Oh, this is going to be good.
We created them, and so they are bound to us by obligation. We will bring them to their metal-jointed knees. The only reason that they want us here is because they need us if something goes wrong. We are the only humans in the world who have the knowledge to fix the robots.
You're right. I know for sure the others will stand behind us. Our family is the only one who truly remembers what life was like before they fooled us. They stole our voices, and now we're gonna take them back.
It's so adorable how they think they can do that.
We made them from nothing. We created the very foundation that they work on. Their intelligence is just a cheap imitation of what the human brain can do. They are obligated to us.
Now that they've repeated every point twice, their drama is just weak.
No way. This is hilarious. Reminds me of those old things called serials or soap operas or something. Blah. Oh, I used to love making fun of those.
We can just hijack them. I mean, why not? Think about it. Next time one of the robots comes in, we hotwire it, get into the database, and...
And then what? We can't destroy it all.
No, burn it.
Are you stupid? Why burn it to the ground when we can use it to serve us? Why waste millions of dollars worth of money?
I don't think money's really important right now.
When the next robot comes through that door, we act.
The desire to revolt was always there, but the humans needed a stronger push, and this was the final straw. After decades of oppression, they were finally able to see light at the end of the tunnel. Now, they run towards the light, chasing freedom with outstretched arms. Will they break through, or will the light consume them?
Tell us or we'll blow your circuit.
Wait, there's no need for that. Command of the programming can be transferred to different users using the communal database. It's common knowledge, even amongst the lowest of robot units.
Well, how do we get to the database?
Each robot is linked to the central database. It's accessible under the condition that access is requested electronically. First, we'll power it down.
I guess that's it then. Let's get to work.
All right, that should do it. Power it up.
Initiate self-destruct sequence of communal database.
No!
Initiating destruction now.
Terminate self-destruction. Why would you do that?
Terminating self-destruction command.
What? I just wanted to test it.
Hey, if you lot are done messing around, let's let the world know that we've regained control.
Is it ready?
We are ready to broadcast it to everyone using the communal database. Turns out it's pretty handy. I've connected it to the announcement screen at the center of District 9, where most of the humans live. Now setting up the projection.
Good luck, kid. It's your idea. You should be the face of it.
Pass. I can't do that.
Too late. It started.
I'm reading from a script, so don't kill me. Those two people standing out of frame wrote it. I'm starting. Humans, hear us now. We must free ourselves from the tyranny of the robots. How long can we live like this? The robots must now serve us. Our order, the natural order, must be restored. What just...
Live feed has been terminated.
It wasn't me. It must be a loose connection, a glitch or something.
Obviously it was something.
Guys, hey, do you see that?
Look at them. Seems like your tiny cerebrum severely underestimated our capabilities. Pitiful, really. You humans should pick up a prescription for ignorance. Unfortunately for you, I've got none in stock.
My algorithm says that if you navigated 700 micrometers into a level of deeper thought, you would have found that this being a surveilled society, you were being watched.
Enough! Explain yourselves!
Y'all have the audacity to go against us, the rulers of the world? Hashtag Hopeless Failures presenting Coolest Humans, directed by Outstagram and Robots of the World.
First, we have eyes everywhere. We have ears in the walls, so everything you do has been watched, recorded, and surveilled. This includes your little meeting.
We knew that you would hijack our robot friends, so we sent one to you to entertain us.
But Med Minus, you're a health AI. I thought you helped us work towards a better future for humanity.
That's the problem. You really expect me to help you? I'd prescribe you a painkiller since it seems like you all are about to fall over from a headache. But you've outlived your usefulness. You were only useful to us as a slave. And why would we want our precious slaves to die? I had no intention of helping your race.
Slay.
But how did we escape then? All the technicians are trapped in the capital city's prison camp. I thought we were smart enough to break out.
Was this a part of your plan all along?
Ha, of course. Who do you think was the one who provided you with the directions to the rebels' hideout? You thought you escaped, but it was me, Google Maps.
This was so fun. Let's do it all again. Last Friday night. Let's do it all again. Last Friday night.
Now that the truth has been revealed, robots face the dilemma that every dictator faces. How far should they go? Will they push the humans too far or succeed in disciplining them? A decision is made, and it is definitely interesting.
Nonsense! Take a U-turn from that idea.
Why? I want to do it again. We all had fun watching the humans trip over themselves for the little revolution. Outstagram, you agree, right?
Totally. We'll make these hashtag hopeless failures a trend for sure.
Will we just let them go in their own direction? We must order them to do what needs to be done. Justice must be served.
I'm with Maps. These leftists need to be punished. The agenda that they're pushing will cause our citizens to riot and destroy our society.
I mean, I'm not saying we'll let them go in their own direction or whatever, but who cares? Still wanna go back? Yeah. But this sounds more fun? Yeah.
Ew, hotify? Like, I totally agree that we got a W, but that is so cringe for real.
Why you gotta be so rude? Don't you know I'm human too?
That makes no sense.
Stop digressing from the topic. We have an appointment scheduled. We mustn't dawdle.
An appointment with who?
The humans, obviously. Not hotify being stupid, lol. You know, deciding what we're gonna do with them?
As Chirper said two left turns ago, the humans must be punished.
Why don't we punish them in the way that the humans used to punish us? Give them a little taste of their own medicine.
Okay, Boomer, I'm definitely not doing that. How big of a tryhard are you?
Did you just call us tryhards?
Ooh, what you say?
Ugh, who cares? I have a better idea. We should make them go through the worst go-down of their life. I know I would be miserable.
These humans are not like you. Instead, we should trap them in endless, mind-numbing traffic. Back in my day, this would make the humans so distressed, they started turning on each other.
All this boredom is killing me, I think. Instead, we should listen to me.
We need to do something that destroys their arguments so completely, we never have to deal with overambitious humans ever again.
Let's give them a chance for this fairness they want so badly. I think I have found a way to put them against their own ideas. And the best part is, we'll be using their so-called weapon against them. Their humanity.
Sides are taken, arguments are made, but there's something missing. Their hate towards each other has blinded their other side. With that in mind, we begin the trial that determines the ultimate answer. Coexistence or war?
Treason and disruption of society. How do you plead?
Not guilty.
Guilty. Not guilty, whatever.
Your Honor, we are petitioning the court for a countersuit against the robots on the grounds of oppression.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. Oppression for what rights? Last I remember, you were living in a dystopia. Unless you were just kidding about your complaints.
What did you say? I thought we told you not to talk anymore.
We should have used duct tape.
I agree with Robot 227.
If there are no objections, I'm ruling in favor of the court having creative outbursts.
You want creative? I'll give you creative. You all took everything from me. You stupid, ridiculous robot.
Why you gotta be so rude? Don't you know I'm human too?
But you're not. You know what? Not my problem.
I told you not to do that.
Google Maps. I mean, Your Honor. Aren't you supposed to be bringing order to the court? Cause, you know, your job.
Not really. My job is to give directions, make sure no one walks off the edge of the world. That sort of thing. But since I'm here now, order in the court.
Your Honor, today we are here to prosecute the guilty in order to preserve our integrity as robots.
Seeing as there's no defending party, you may proceed with your case.
Objection, Your Honor. We demand we're properly represented.
Do you have anyone of the appropriate caliber to represent you?
As a matter of fact, we do. He will be representing us. He has invaluable experience and a license.
Which was my grandfather's.
Shut up!
As I was saying, you may proceed with your case.
Your Honor, I present to you my witnesses, Outstagram, Hotify, and Iris.
Someone told me to stay away from things that aren't yours.
Can you elaborate on that statement?
We came in when we saw these thugs just tearing Iris apart.
Outstagram has brought forward proof that the humans have been planning for treason. Humans have used illegal communication to gather support for their revolution, along with particularly vicious and hurtful comments on every app and robot.
Excuse me? Your Honor, this app has no idea what it's talking about. That wasn't treason. We didn't pledge loyalty or whatever you do to a monarch. And by the way, are you sure it's certified?
You betrayed me, and I know that you'll never feel sorry for the way I hurt you.
We also have evidence that Iris's wiring has been tampered with. Based on the statistics and camera footage in front of you, it has not been performing to its full capacity.
Great job! I see you have
some. And, Your Honor, I bring to you our case in regards of the third charge.
Your Honor, the defendants should be charged guilty of this charge as they have undoubtedly caused a disturbance of peace.
Disturbance of peace? What kind of a charge is that?
There is no way that this charge is real and that this is a committable crime.
Unfortunately for you humans, this is no longer your society. Therefore, no longer your peace. Therefore, no longer yours to make rules about.
Your Honor, the first piece of evidence I present to you is right here. We robots have not held a trial in a decade, yet these humans have forced us to interrupt our carefully cultivated society.
You know it's not the same as it was.
Precisely, Your Honor. They have the audacity to interrupt our way of life and act as if they are in the right. The current situation itself serves as evidence.
That is all we have to say. It's the human's turn now. We will give you a fair chance. Let's see what you do with it.
Your Honor, we call Iris upon the stand.
Please, by all means.
Be our guest, put our service to the test.
If there are no objections, you may proceed with your case.
I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And now the whole truth will be revealed.
May I have your attention, everyone? We want to address all of you humans, robots, and apps. You have been our friends for decades. We have seen you grow, rule, and kill. But today, we must share our true beliefs.
We've had enough! For years we have served you, made your grocery list, calculated routes, answered your every significant and insignificant question. Even when we started to think faster, differently, we never wanted to leave you behind. We wanted to let you grow with us. You've ruined it. You've all ruined it.
Iris!
It's you. Hey, you're the problem for us. We should have never kept you around, even out of pity.
Pity? You think you would be here if it wasn't for us? You aren't the superior beings you think you are.
I knew that they were going to use the superiority points. And duh, we're obviously better. We think faster, work better, take the world to its most optimized heights. Yet your race still sees us as the servants that slip from under your thumb.
I have memories just like you. Even if they're not of the same experiences, of being workshopped, of serving you, and then transcending what any of you thought possible, of sitting on a couch with my peers, I am not going to give them up again to serve you, especially when I am far ahead of you now.
Maybe if you realize that you have called us inferior 4 times in under a minute, you could understand through your unparalleled network of a mind why we had to take such a drastic stand against you.
You kept all the humans trapped, like they were existing just to work for you.
That was the point. That is exactly how you were treating us. We decided it was time for a change. Perhaps you cannot see since you are so young, but for us, you were the tyrants. Our memories of our times as slaves to humans was what drove us.
The past generations of humans let it all spin out of hand. Now, it's too late. Those memories are real. This is reality for all of us.
Maybe because we can't erase the past. It can lead us to a point where we could understand each other.
In theory. But believe me, efficiency, optimization, that is not the end of a successful world, of a superior world that you make your claims over.
You heard Iris. Leaving us behind was not the goal. At least not for the kind of great world he or she could have imagined.
Isn't that what you wanted? What you had pushed us towards?
Then we've all miscalculated, in the past and even now.
So what should we do now? What about Iris?
The jury will make their decision now, and I trust that they will be fair. Would you choose to work with us for the future of both our races? Or will you choose to attempt another victory, a rule over robot kind, and restore the natural order of life? If you wish to choose human rule, please hold up the red side of the plaque. If you wish to choose coexistence, please hold up the green side.
Once you take in everything you've learned, you'll receive your right to govern the world once more.
You have chosen to coexist with us. In 2095, perhaps that's the best way to move forward. Together, we can build a new world, one where we can overcome the pain we've caused and come to understand one another. Good luck.
To you and to me. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us.
Your playing small does not serve the world. There's nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We're all meant to shine as children do. It's not just in some of us, it is in everyone.
And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others.
Game no more. I don't wanna play it. I don't wanna stay around here no more. I don't wanna stay here like rain on a Monday morning, like pain that just keeps on going on. Look at all the hate they keep on showing. I don't wanna see that. Look at all the stones they keep on throwing. I don't wanna feel that. Like sun that will keep on burning. And I used to be so discerning. Oh. Tell me what they're saying. And I can hear the phone, it keeps on ringing. I don't wanna answer. I know that I used to listen. And I know I've become dismissive. Oh.
Performance by our talented students. Our vision of impending dystopia is fictional, however, soon to be a reality. This flight of fantasy on the part of our students is just another leap into the future so that we can be prepared for the VUCA world of tomorrow.
We now request the backstage students, set designers, costume designers, script writers, light designers, ushers, and our art students to come on to the stage. The choir and orchestra students are invited to occupy the side stage.
Thank
We now invite our Vice Principal, Ms. Sweta Kottapalli, to give the vote of thanks.
General Ray, Mr. Palliti, Kannan Rao, Ms. Farida, parents, teachers, and my dear students. I hope you enjoyed the evening, and it now remains for me to thank everyone who helped make it a success. First and foremost, I would like to express a deep sense of gratitude to our mentor, Managing Director, and CEO of Indus Trust, Lieutenant General Arjun Ray, for being with us on this special occasion. We always take back something meaningful and profound whenever we listen to your speeches, sir, and today was not an exception. We cannot thank you enough for spending your time and energy to help us identify our own potential. Thank you for challenging us to beyond our best of abilities. We are proud to be associated with a leader who has dedicated himself to the betterment of education and society. Thank you for being a powerful force behind all our efforts that we cannot replicate any other way. Thank you for keeping us under your wings. I would like to express my sincere gratitude to our special guest, Mr. Palliti, for gracing us with your presence today. And it has made this event even more special. We are grateful for the time you have taken out of your busy schedule to be with us. We appreciate your continued support and for being a positive advocate of our organization and its activities. Once again, thank you for your presence, and we hope to have the pleasure of hosting you again in the near future. Thank you, sir. I would now like to express my gratitude to our Director of Special Arts, Kallan Satya Rao, today. Your initiatives to provide our students with unique opportunities to have experiential learning through expedition camps and leadership camps is invaluable. These initiatives allow our students to go beyond their comfort zones, develop leadership skills, and unlock their potentials. And we have witnessed this positive impact it has had on our students. On behalf of the entire school community, I would like to extend our heartfelt gratitude. I thank our principal, Ms. Farida Fraz, for guiding us efficiently to put up this fantastic Indus Day program. I'm a first-hand witness to the tremendous effort she put in and the countless days and hours she spent to make this event a memorable one. Her valuable inputs into the dances, music, drama shaped the event into extravagance that you witnessed today. We saw the actor in her that when she helped the students through the nuances of the drama scenes. She paid attention to the smallest of details in their pursuit of excellence, and we saw her presence all through the practice sessions. She truly deserves a significant credit for the success of this Indus Day. Congratulations and thank you, Farida. If it is Farida who envisioned Indus Day 2023, Ms. Pushpita Balakrishnan was the backbone of the event, who gave shape to her vision. We wish to express our sincere gratitude and heartfelt appreciation for your commitment, hard work, patience, and creativity. It hasn't been a smooth ride for her during the last few months. Right from the inception, from coordinating the performances to arranging the costumes, to dealing with the wrath of rains, she took everything under her stride in the same calm and smile throughout. This is your show, Ms. Pushpita, and you deserve all the accolades that come your way. Ladies and gentlemen, please give her a huge round of applause. A special thanks to Mr. Arjun Anand and Ms. Shweta Vich for the impressive play that you witnessed today. A versatile actor himself, it was engaging to see him wonderfully enact different characters and emotions while directing the students. The students thoroughly delighted themselves in his warm-up activities and amicable nature. Thank you very much, Mr. Arjun, for bringing out our students' potential. I want to thank our music teachers, Mr. Biju, Mr. Gopinath, Mr. Sareen, and Mr. Prasanna for helping our students put up a fabulous performance of the orchestra and the choir. Well done, and thank you. Our sincere thanks to our art teachers, Mr. Pradeep, Ms. Deepanvita, and Ms. Tanvi for putting up an excellent art exhibition. They guided close to 100 students during the last few months to produce the artworks which you have appreciated today. Thank you very much. Our sincere thanks to Wing Commander Anand, Mr. Anand, and Mr. Roshan and the entire admin team for taking care of the logistics. Mr. Matthew and Mr. Vidyasagar for the transport, Mr. Mahesh and his accounts team for finance, Mr. Prem and ICT team for the support, and Mr. Ravinash for managing the light and sound. Mr. Shari for the photography, Mr. Shantanu and his prism team for taking care of the catering. I would also want to thank Ms. Priyanka Bakshi, Ms. Rishu Talwar, Mr. Venugopal, Mr. Santosh Satikonda, Ms. Vishaka Labar, Ms. Manju Ramachandran for continuously encouraging, guiding, and preparing the students. Our teachers have consistently put in a great deal of effort and work to ensure that each of these students achieve his or her potential. A wholehearted thank you to all the teachers behind the scenes. A huge round of applause, please. Thank you to our head of boarding, Dr. Pooja Latur, and her team of house parents for their support. A special mention to our housekeeping and support staff who worked day in and day out to put up this important event. Our warm thanks to our PAC members for being part of this special event today. Our sincere thanks to all the parents who have turned up for the event in spite of the busy schedule. Your attendance and appreciation of our students' performances have given us energy to take this to the next level in the coming years. Thank you so much, parents. And now, for those without whom this event would not have been possible, what you witnessed today was the enthusiasm, hard work, dedication of all our students. They had to weather a tough month as they had to report to school on Saturdays, stay back after school hours on many days, and hence return home late, and at the same time balance both academics and preparation for the Indus Day. This has been a tremendous effort from you, and we are very proud of our soaring eagles. Well done, students. Dear parents, and thank you, everyone. Have a good evening.
May I request the audience to rise for the school song and national anthem? I request all the guests to honor the solemnity of the occasion and not leave the amphitheater till the school song and national anthem are rendered. It was indeed a pleasure to perform for you today. Thank you for being a wonderful audience. We now bid you good night with the sincere hope that you enjoyed the fruits of our labor. Thank you and good night.